As we were worshiping God, brought the story back to my mind and felt just a bit of a word I want to share before I go ahead and preach. The other day, I was home alone with Linnea, and she came down the stairs. And she had dressed up in her princess costume. And she comes sauntering down the stairs, as only Linnea can saunter, with full of attitude and understanding of who she is. The girl lacks no, I would like to say, she's a bit like her dad that way. And it's a good thing sometimes. But she's all dressed up, and she's got her little fake jewelry on and her little crown. And she's like, "So, are you going to take me on a date now or what?" And it was a funny moment, and it was, you know, I really felt like God was speaking to me this morning about that. Just that you have to prepare for what you want. You know, it's really easy to want things. It's really easy to desire things. But I feel like God is issuing a challenge right now to some of us that you have to prepare for what you want. Linnea got her date. But she prepared for it. And I think oftentimes, and I shared this on Tuesday at prayer, we want breakthrough. And we're like, you know, we're like, "Oh God, I just want breakthrough. And God, I need breakthrough in this area of my life." And much like the woman with the issue of blood, who there was a crowd between her and Jesus, and she had to push through the crowd to touch the hem to get her healing. And I feel like God is saying is that, you know, breakthrough is on us as well. It's not enough just to want it and to hope for it, to even pray for it, but there's an aspect of breakthrough that's on you. If you really want the breakthrough, what are you doing to achieve the breakthrough? What are you going after? What are you putting in place? How are you preparing yourself? And I also felt this, and I was a little bit like, "Oh God, I don't really want to say that," but I feel like God's saying for some that you need to commit to going forward. You need to commit to moving forward. And even in place of with here at Cheers, that there for some of you, there needs to be a greater commitment where you're kind of in and you're kind of out, you're kind of here and then you aren't, and you're like, you're kind of wavering. And I feel like the Lord just wants to challenge you this morning. Commit to going forward. Commit to being part of the body and prepare yourself, because God is at work and God still is doing things, and there's things that God wants to do in your life and through your life, but there's an aspect where you have to commit to it and you have to prepare yourself. So just I pray that you receive that, and it goes along so well with what Sarah shared. And that was a prophetic proclamation over this church and into our community, that God really does want to see the youth and see youth come into this place, but there's the aspect of preparation. On a totally unrelated topic, I have a message to preach this morning, which I'm sure will be just as amazing. I could get an amen there. A little bit of faith here, people. Come on, work with me. Believe for the greater things. I was talking to someone the other day, and they asked me why some people had left the church. And it was kind of funny. Not like ha-ha funny. But it was kind of funny because when most people leave, and the thing is, they never come and talk to you as a pastor. As a matter of fact, I've had people avoid talking to me. I've actually tried to set up meetings with people, and they don't show up. I've had people like take me, unfriend me off Facebook, and just like, it's just bizarre to me in a lot of ways. But this person came and asked me this, and I thought about it, and I realized, see, somewhere along the line, there was some kind of failed expectation. Something they wanted, something they hoped for, some kind of relationship, maybe some kind of platform. They had an expectation that wasn't realized. And in my 17 years of pastoring, I've seen that one of the biggest killers to any kind of relationship is failed expectations. I've seen young marriages break down because people had an expectation of what the marriage would be, but the reality is so much different, as my wife would attest. It's like my kids, like they want a dog. Like they want a dog in the worst way. I mean, I've been hearing about a dog for the last probably 5 or 6 years now. And there's this desire for this dog. And I'm just going to say, you know, I'm just like one of those mean dads at times. I'm like, no, we aren't getting a dog. But see, in their mind, they think, you know, when they think about the dog, they think about talking to the dog and cuddling with the dog and playing with the dog. You know, they have all these expectations of how awesome it's going to be to have this little puppy that's just going to love them, and they're just going to want to spend all this time with him, and it's going to be this, you know, this beautiful relationship of rainbows and lollipops and, you know, sprinkles. Yes, like that's in their mindset. That's what they picture, right? See, they have the expectation of what having a dog is going to be like. But see, I've had a dog. You know, when I think about a dog, I think about getting up at 6 a.m. to take the stupid dog for a pee because he's whining and scraping at the door. I think about finding my stuff torn up because the dog decided to chew on it. I think about picking up dog poo. I don't want to pick up dog poo. Like, I have a real issue with picking up dog poo. Like I feel like I'm the superior being, okay? If anyone should be picking up anyone's poo, the dog should be picking up my poo. Like, come on. I can drive. I can read. He, like, sniffed butts. Like, what? Like, doesn't that seem wrong? Bet you didn't think you'd hear about dog poo this morning at church. See, we all have expectations, and so we all have times of failed expectations as well. And that can be really hard to deal with because we get disappointed. And failed expectations can cause all kinds of havoc. It can cause relationships to end. It can cause offense to take place. It can cause hurt and disappointment. And that's just on a human level. But there's another area where we often experience failed expectations. And that's the place I want to look at this morning. And that's in our relationship with God. See, we often fall into a mindset that our behavior determines God's response to us. That when we fail in our Christian walk, we then reduce God's love and favor in our lives. That because we fail to live up to what we think of our God's expectations, we limit the love and goodness God has for us. And the problem with this kind of thinking is then we feel that we have to live up to God's expectations in order to have God's love. That having God in my life is based on me, and that's a real scary thought. See, that mindset is a work-based relationship, where we're trying to live these perfect lives based on getting and achieving from God. The trouble is, life is never perfect or balanced. And no matter how hard I try, I can never keep the scales tilted in my favor, or even keep them balanced for that matter. And when you're trying to have a relationship based on your ability to please someone's expectations, you then live with a tremendous sense of judgment, guilt, and pressure. And those things are far, far, far from the heart of God. See, your relationship with God needs to be based on love. And we are taught, rightly so, that God is love. The Bible says in 1 John 4:8, whoever does not love God, whoever does not love does not know God, because God is love. And so what is love? Well, 1 Corinthians 13 tells us love is patient, love is kind, it does not envy, it does not boast, it is not proud, it does not keep dishonor. It does not dishonor others. It's not self-seeking. It's not easily angered. It keeps no record of wrong. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres. Love never fails. See, nowhere on the list does it say love is demanding. Or that love demands perfection, or that love pressures you, or that there's an expectation for being loved. See, understand what I'm trying to say this morning. I'm not saying that there shouldn't be a response to being loved. Love should cause us to be different, that we're loved should change us. That's the story. That's the power of his love. But his love and his goodness and his favor are not found in our ability to keep a list of rules. And we see this so clearly in the story of the prodigal son, and that's where I want to go this morning. And I think we got up on the screen, Luke 15. There was a man who had two sons. The younger one said to his father, "Father, give me my share of the estate." So he divided his property between them. Not long after that, the younger son got together all he had and set off for a distant country, and there squandered his life in wild living. After he'd spent everything, there was a severe famine in the whole country, and he began to be in need. So he went and hired himself out to a citizen of that country, who sent him to his fields to feed pigs. He longed to fill his stomach with the pods the pigs were eating, but no one gave him anything. When he came to his senses, he said, "How many of my father's hired servants have food to spare? And here I am starving to death. I will set out and go back to my father and say to him, 'Father, I've sinned against heaven and against you. I'm no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired servants.' So he got up and went to his father. But while he was still a long ways off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion for him. He ran to his son, threw his arms around him, and kissed him." That's a beautiful picture right there. Understand, that's how God sees you. Wherever you're at in your relationship with God, no matter where you find yourself in those moments of failure and doubt and fear, understand that's how God sees you. He sees you with compassion. He runs to you. The son said to him, "Father, I've sinned against heaven and against you. I'm no longer worthy to be called your son." But the father said to his servant, "Quick, bring the best robe and put it on him. Put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet. Bring the fatted calf and kill it. Let's have a feast and celebrate. It's a good day for everyone but the calf. For this son of mine was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found." So they began to celebrate. Meanwhile, the older son was in the field. When he came near the house, he heard the music and dancing. So he called to one of the servants and asked him what was going on. "Your brother has come," he replied, "and your father has killed the fatted calf because he has him back safe and sound." The older brother became angry and refused to go in. So his father went out and pleaded with him. But he answered the father, "Look, all these years I've been slaving for you and never disobeyed your orders. Yet you never gave me even a young goat so I could celebrate with my friends. But when the son of yours who has squandered your property with prostitutes comes home, you kill the fatted calf for him." "My son," the father said, "you're always with me and everything I have is yours. But we had to celebrate and be glad because this brother of yours was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found." I love that story. So much in that story. There's so much truth in that story. But my first point this morning to not living with failed expectation is you have to know that your worth is not found in what you do. See, whether we're playing in the pig pen or working diligently for the Father, our worth never changes. Our worth never changes. Like, it's imperative that we understand this. Truly, this point alone will change your Christian walk. And truly, this is something we continue to have to go back to. I know I do, that my worth never changes based on me. Listen, the young said, he says, "Father, I've sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son." Is there anything sadder than when we think that somehow I'm no longer worthy? I mean, there's no sugarcoating what he's done. He confesses his sin, but then he also makes this statement that he's no longer worthy to be called a son. See, when we think our actions and conduct somehow determine God's love and acceptance of us, that's bad theology. Because what you're saying is, if I was good enough, then I'd be worthy. If I was good enough, if I did enough, if I. see, you're cheapening grace when you do that. You're saying what Jesus did on the cross was not good enough, that you have to add to it. You have to add your works. You have to add your ability to keep all the rules. You have to add. You're essentially changing the whole gospel message. You know, I guess Jesus got it wrong when he said it is finished. Apparently, he forgot about your sin. Like, what I'm saying this morning isn't new, but I want to come back to it because I've seen so many people put all this pressure on themselves. And live with such a small understanding of God's grace and love. Always feeling that they have to measure up or they aren't good enough or like God's always disappointed in them. Listen, God doesn't want you to see them that way. Ephesians 2 verse 1 says, all of us also lived among them at one time, gratifying the cravings of our flesh and following its desires and thoughts. Like the rest, we were by nature deserving of wrath, but because of his great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ even when we were dead in transgressions. It is by grace you have been saved. And God raised us up with Christ and seated us with him in the heavenly realm in Christ Jesus, in order that in the coming ages he might show the incomparable riches of his grace expressed in his kindness to us in Christ Jesus. For it is by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not from yourself. It is the gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast. For we are God's handiwork created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. See, he didn't just save us and leave us. We aren't just scraping the bottom of the barrel of grace. We aren't just somehow making it. His grace, it says, raised us up with Christ. His grace has seated us with Christ in the heavenly realms. His grace would show us kindness. Like, it's not just enough grace to get by. And this is the place that grace takes us to, where God sees you like he sees Jesus. You know, the real problem with the mindset of undeserved worth is then that you limit your ability to dream. See, we don't dream when we don't feel secure. We don't reach for our potential when we don't feel accepted. We don't believe for more when we feel unworthy. 1 John 4:9 says, this is how God showed his love amongst us. He sent his one and only son into the world that we might live through him. And this is key. It's through Christ that we have our acceptance. It's through Christ that we have our sonship. It's through Christ. And he wants us to live. Did you get that? To live through him. Not just get by, not just make it, but that we would live through him. He raises us up to that place so that we can dream, so that we can reach our potential, so that there can be more. Your acceptance is never based. Your worth is never based. Your value is never based on what you do. They were both the Father's sons. That never changed. Point number two to not living with failed expectations is understanding there's always an aspect of reaping what we sow in our lives. We need to see the separation between our worth as a child of God and the fact that we still reap what we sow. This story actually shows it quite well because we see in this story the good son received a good life for how he lived. He reaped what he sowed. So he never went without. He never went hungry. He never lived with pigs. He reaped what he sowed. The prodigal son, he also reaped what he sowed. He made the choice to live apart from the father, so he went without. So he lived with the pigs. He went hungry. He felt the shame of his choices. They both had an aspect of reaping what they sowed in their lives. But understand, neither gained the father's love, neither gained his favor by how they lived. The father loved all his children the same, but they reaped what they sowed. And I think this is important because oftentimes we think, well, how I live is somehow a determination of how God sees me and how God values me. And if there's good things in my life, then that must mean that I'm in good standing with God and that God really values me, because look at all this good things. And so I must have a lot of worth. I must have a lot of value because my life is good. That somehow our behavior should cause God to be, has caused God to be more favorable to us. But it's not God's favor. It's a principle that's at work in our lives. See, if I sow good, I'll reap good. That's a principle. That's a fact. That's how it works. So if I get up and go to work, I'll get a paycheck. It's not that God loves me more or favors me more, but I'm reaping what I sowed. And guess what? If I don't get up and go to work, there won't be a paycheck on Friday, and it's not because God loves me less. It's because I'm reaping what I sowed. See, I think there's sometimes confusion in our lives about this, where we think that, well, because there's good things in my life, that somehow that determines my standing with God. And I just kind of want to clear that up a little bit to really help us understand. No, it's about that my value, that does never change. I can't change my value. I cannot change my worth. I'm incapable of doing that. You're incapable of doing that. Your value and your worth is always the same, but you may have some good things in your life because you've sown some good things, and so you're going to reap those things. The prodigal son, his value was always there. He was always a son. That was never going to change. It didn't matter how far away he went from the father. It didn't matter where he found himself. He was always going to be a son. He couldn't change that if he wanted to change it. God has said and God has spoken, you're my son, and that will never change. But, if you choose to reap like wild living, if you choose to go and just squander everything, if you choose to live a life of debauchery, guess what you're going to reap? It's not that God values you less. It's not that your worth has somehow changed. And on the plus side, and this is important for us in the church, because sometimes our thinking gets a little messed up. We think, well, look at my life. It's so good, you know. But well, yeah, it is, because you know what? You made good choices. You sow good things. You come to church. You care about your family. You go to work. So yeah, there's a natural reaping that takes place. And so there's good things in your life. But it doesn't make your value any more important. It doesn't make your worth somehow greater. It's just that you're reaping what you sowed. Good on you. Good on you. And your life is going to be a lot better. I mean, I work in a prison. I mean, I see these people come in and it's just like this story. And it's just, it gets worse and worse and worse and worse. And it just, there's so much dysfunction and discord and anger and all these things. And it's, you know, that's what they're sowing. That's what they're reaping. But it doesn't change the Father's love. It doesn't change that they have value to God that's beyond understanding. And the challenge for me and the people I work with is not allow their actions to determine how I see their value. The challenge for all of us is not to allow someone's actions to determine how we see their value, because we have to see them through the eyes of grace and through the eyes of God's love and say, well, no, there's a value there that is beyond comprehension. There's a worth there. Yeah, their actions, yeah, they should be in jail, but... But that does not change the value of who they are. That is good, Melissa. Thank you. That was good worship today, too. See, so often in our church culture, we make success the sign of God's favor. That somehow the more I have or the more recognition I get means something about my closeness to God. I must be favored of God because of the comfort of my life. And while the church of 2017 might teach that, the early church of the apostles who were being beaten and jailed and persecuted, they didn't experience that. If we look how their lives turned out, we could say, well, huh, you know, I guess God didn't really favor them. The older son gets pretty arrogant and self-righteous in his thinking because he confused these two things. He assumed that the goodness of his living must mean something about how the father viewed him. Let me say that again. He assumed that the goodness of his living must mean something about how the father viewed him. Yes, Scripture teaches us that there's no substitute for our heart, that your heart before God is the only gauge that God looks at. My third point to not living with failed expectation is understanding your favor is the presence of the Father. See, when you think about your worth and God's goodness, when you think your worth and your and God's goodness is based on what you do, you're no longer living under grace. So you're then limited to what you can access based on what you can do. See, the older son didn't realize he had access too. He didn't realize that, like, he was with the Father, and the Father says, everything I have is yours. Like, he had access to everything. But because he didn't have the grace to receive it, he couldn't walk in it. Because he didn't think he could have more, his thinking was that he had to earn it. He had this thinking that somehow he couldn't get it unless he earned it. But the Father said, everything I have is yours. What a powerful statement. Everything I have is already yours. You know, the Bible teaches the same thing for us. 2 Peter 1:3 says, his divine power has given us everything we need for a godly living through our knowledge of him who's called us by his own glory and goodness. Romans 8:17 says, now if we are children, then we are heirs, heirs of God and co-heirs with Christ. Everything I have is yours. See, this means just like Jesus, everything the Father has is ours. We have access to everything the Father has. Bill Johnson says it like this, and Bill Johnson's a much smarter man than I am. He says, favor is preferential treatment shown to somebody. It denotes the acceptance, approval, and pleasure. God gives us his grace to empower us to become like Christ. And then, you know, I think, man, I should just take this out and make it sound like, yeah, because it says, you know, talks about the Greek and the Hebrew and how it's translated. And I think, oh, I should just, you know, we'll put that up there. I'll just make it sound like, oh, you know, well, the Greek and the Hebrew says. But I knew you guys would be on to me, so I thought, no, I better not do that. So I'll just, well, the Greek and the Hebrew words translate favor in Scripture includes these definitions. There is a deeper dimension to the Greek word for favor, charez. Is that right? No? Close? Charez. Almost everywhere in the New Testament, this word is translated grace. Grace and favor is essentially a gift. If we gain favor with people, or as we might say, get into their good graces, we have special access to them and we receive something from them. The same thing is true about gaining favor with God. Although the charis we receive from God is obviously different from the favor we receive from men. At our conversion, we learn that God's grace is his unmerited favor towards men through the blood of his son. This unmerited favor includes not only being forgiven of sin, but also receiving access, there's that word again, access to the very presence of God in the same way Jesus had access to him. See, that is the favor. I think it's another slide. Is that it? See, every believer receives favor from God. But we don't always recognize the additional dimension of the charis we receive. God's grace is also his operational power, the force of his nature, his gifts. He gives us to this grace to empower us to become like Christ. See, the older son, the favor was there. The whole time, the favor was there. Because what? Why? The favor is the Father. So the favor was always there. He just had to access the favor. He just had to walk in the favor. And he had to humble himself in order to receive the favor because it was only by grace, not by his works. And that's the difference. The younger son comes to the Father, and what does he do? He humbles himself. He knew he had blew it. He knew aside from grace, he had access to nothing. But in his humbleness, the favor is released over his life. Do you see that in the story? How when he comes and he humbles himself, what does the father do? The father gets the best robe, gets the ring, kills the fatted calf. Like this tremendous favor as he humbles himself is just released over his life. Again, not because he had done anything, but simply because he came in humbleness and said, Father, I have sinned. And then the grace of God, the favor of God. Like that's so powerful and it's so strong. And we look at this story and then we see the older son, he doesn't want anything to do with it because he's thinking, well, I have to make this happen. I somehow have to make the grace be there for me by how I conduct and live my life. And he never gets all these things, yet the son who's out living this wild, crazy life, he gets all the good things. Why? Because the favor is in the Father. The favor is in the Father. And as we come to the Father and we simply humble ourselves and we say, God, I want your presence. God, I need your presence above all things. Then the favor of God is released. And it has nothing to do with how good you've lived your life. It's simply a recognition that the favor and grace is found only in him. And that's the beauty of it. The beauty of it is really that takes all the pressure off. It's not about me performing. It's not about me being good enough. It's not about my ability. It's simply him. It makes the Christian walk so much more enjoyable and better when it's not about me somehow having to perform and make it happen. It's simply his favor because I'm his son. Doesn't that feel good? Because it's so hard otherwise. Like, no wonder we look in the story and the older son, no wonder he's miserable. He doesn't want to have a party. He doesn't want to celebrate. Because he's trying so hard to do all the right things. He's trying so hard to perform the right way. He's trying so hard and it just sucks the life out of him. And this is the religion that many Christians put out there. Oh, you know, I got to live this straight and narrow. Yes, you do have to live the straight and narrow, but it's not this. Oh, I got to do it in my own strength. I got to make it happen. No one wants that. They want the religion of freedom. They want the religion of love. They want the religion of grace and mercy. And it's only found in the presence of the Father. He just comes and says, God, Father, I'm sorry. I've sinned. And it's like, whoosh. The best robe, the ring, the fatted calf. We're having a party. That's the favor. Basically, I just summed up all that stuff that Bill Johnson said, but it's just in a simpler way. See, sometimes we're like the older son and we don't understand what we have access to. And so we become content to live around the Father but never access the Father. See, everything of the Father's was his. And there was always more there for him than he realized. See, the favor is we have the same access to the Father as Jesus did. We have the same access to the Father as Jesus. That means that at any moment we can come into his presence. At any moment. At any moment you can receive strength. At any moment you can find peace. Like, you understand how powerful that is? As you're going through your life, when you're facing tough times, when you're dealing with hard situations, you have the ability, just like Jesus, to come to the Father. Well, everyone around you is trying to claw their way ahead and is full of anxiety and fear and all this, and they're dealing with hard things, but they have to do it in their own strength, in their own ability. I mean, just think about how tiring that is. Like, I understand my limitations, and trust me, if I had to do it in myself, I mean, it would be a mess. But because I can access the Father, it's the only thing. It's the only thing in my life. Because I can, I mean, you... you look at my life right now, you say, oh, but I mean, trust me, without the Father, it would be really bad. I mean, but because I have that access, because I have that grace, because I have that wisdom that's beyond my wisdom, I mean, sometimes I come up with ideas, and I'm like, whoa, and I'm just like, thank you, God, because this is too limited. It's the favor. And at any moment, it's there. At any moment. I mean, I think we overlook that, just much like him. Like he was around the Father. The story says the older son was around the Father the whole time. But he overlooked what he had. He overlooked what he had access to. And I think sometimes we're like that because we're so used to it. We're so used to having that access to God that sometimes we just take it for granted and we don't even realize the potential and the power of what we have access to. We don't even understand the ability of what we have access to. So when I'm going through the hard time of my day, I have the opportunity, I can just begin to praise him and the peace of God comes. I can begin to praise him and I can focus on not what I'm going through in this moment, but I can focus on who he is and what he's doing in my life. And I have that access all the time. But sometimes when we grew up around it or even when we've been around it for a while, we fall into this trap of, oh yeah, but God's there, but I got this problem. God's there, but this is going on in my life. God's there, but I got to deal with this. And we forget, no, wait a minute. If I go here first, if I access here first, then this will be taken care of. But we get so focused and we think, no, because we get so deadened to having that access. We take it for granted. Like the older son, he always had access. Everything was there for him the whole time, but he was too busy focusing on what he thought he didn't have. Now, let me tell you, if you can't celebrate what you do have, you're never going to get what you think you need. You have to celebrate where you're at first before you get what you need. And that leads me to my fourth point. To not live with failed expectation is understanding we have to celebrate. And we have to celebrate with others. You can't celebrate with others until you realize and celebrate what you have. You can't celebrate with others until you realize and celebrate what you have first. I wrote something down during worship and I have no idea what it says. This would change your life, this statement, but my handwriting is so bad, we're all messed up now. But you can't celebrate with others until you recognize and celebrate what you have first. He couldn't go celebrate because he didn't recognize what he had. He had the Father the whole time, and he never celebrated that. I think another aspect that, I'm sorry, I'm just all over the place because I got like all this revelation during the worship and then I'm trying to fit into what I actually had written down first. But I think a lot of times we have a hard time celebrating with others just because we think we have to compete. We have to compete for the Father's love, his affection. Like somehow God only has so much love to go around. Like when we think that my sex success somehow proves, you know, God's love, then I need that success to show that God loves me. Like I need to somehow, what my life looks like is somehow proves God's acceptance and his love of me. And so then I can't celebrate what someone else, God is doing in someone else's life because it's this competition. I gotta get that love. I got to get the acceptance. Like somehow, you know, there's only so much room on God's lap for his kids. Like somehow he loves other kids better than us. I mean, it's such a warped way of thinking because even as a natural father, I don't love one over the other. Like I could have, you know, 5 more kids and I would probably be slightly demented and crazy, but I'd have enough love for the other ones. It wouldn't be like, oh, I'd have to stop with Elizabeth and Linnea. And so there's no limit to God's love. So we should be able to celebrate when we really understand that our worth is not based on what we do, but rather on what he's already done, who he is in our life, then we should be able to celebrate what he's doing in others because we understand there's no limit. See, a grace mindset celebrates our brothers. A grace mindset knows there's no limit to the Father's love and goodness, favor. Like the Father's story, he had lots of cattle. It wasn't like there was only one fatted calf in the herd. There was all kinds of fatted calf to kill. And here's the older son sitting outside, pouting, missing on the party. Sometimes I feel like that's the church. Missing out on the party. Missing out on the fun. Like, that's lame. Don't be that guy. We're invited too, but you only get in if you're going with celebration. If you're willing to celebrate. Why don't you stand with me this morning? Lord, we just thank you this morning, God. The simple truth of your scripture teaches us, God, that we're all your favorites. That your lap is big enough for all of us just to come and sit on it, God, and just to receive and be in your presence, God. And Father, I pray that you would just help us to really comprehend and understand in the deep places of our hearts and the deep places of our thinking, God, just how unlimited your grace and your affection and your goodness is. And Lord, I pray that as we rest in that and as we just walk in that, God, that we'd be people who would sow good lives, good seeds. Father, that we would live those lives because your love has changed us, because your love has transformed us, God. And that we would share that joy that comes only from you, God, into those around us. So, Lord, I just thank you this morning for your word. I thank you for your worship. I thank you, Lord, that once again you brought us into your presence and you readjusted us and you realigned us and you changed some of our thinking, God. And, Father, that we receive from you, God, what can never be taken from us, that we are your sons and your daughters. I bless this church. I bless these people. We bless our community, God. We thank you. In the name of Christ Jesus, and all God's people said, amen. 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 Be blessed.